Today, I have the pleasure to introduce the second forum in our series of high-growth technology business life case studies, which is another result of a successful cooperation between the European Patent Office and the Licensing Executive Society International. This online seminar will look at various business aspects of licensing and the opportunities it offers for high-growth technology companies, as well as showcasing a real-life success story presented by our special guest today, Francisco Castro, who is the Chief IP Counsel of the quantum computing startup IonQ. My name is Ilya Rudik, and I am part of the EPO's Chief Economist Unit, where our goal is to raise awareness and to improve the understanding about the business and economic value of intellectual property. What we observe is that the importance of the licensing of intellectual property has increased tremendously over the past decades. According to the recent statistics by the World Bank, worldwide charges for the use of IP, and licensing is a core aspect here, have grown sixfold over the last 20 years from $75 billion in 2000 to over $450 billion in 2020. Licensing is also of utmost importance for technology transfer from universities and from small and medium-sized enterprises and their commercial exploitation. Indeed, our service that we carried out in Europe showed that 62% of small and medium-sized enterprises and 70% of universities see licensing as the preferred commercialization channel for their patented technologies, and often also the main reason for patenting in the first place. Today's live case study will touch upon the business aspect of licensing from the perspective of a high-growth company, which is operating in a new and fast-growing quantum industry. With that, I would like to hand over to Dana, our co-host and partner from Lacey, and who will be your moderator today.
Thanks so much. Thanks for that intro. As you said, this is a licensing forum where LESI is really proud to be a partner with EPO in this series of sessions. You know, we often talk about how we learn from case studies. This is a great way to not only be able to hear about a great case study, but really kind of pull it apart from a number of different angles. So really happy to do that. And thanks for that intro. You know, the forum was developed specifically for business decision makers. And we focus here on licensing. We focused on a number of other topics of the financing, building to sell, and others. I have served as the overall host. I'm Dana Colarulli. I'm the executive director of the Licensing Executive Society. And as I said, we're happy to do this series now in year two. It really is to provide IP awareness and IP know-how for relevant businesses, to expand the community of business decision makers, have us all using the same language, and frankly, expand the community of IP professionals to effectively transfer technology into the marketplace. So we encourage you to become part of the HTB community. You'll learn more about the other sessions. I'll give a promo for the next one, which we added this year new on open innovation, which will happen on June 15th. So who is LESI? LESI, for those of you who are unfamiliar, is a global trade association, about 33 individual societies, although we may be 34 soon, but more than 90 countries serving about 6,500 individuals. We're entering into our 50th year, and we focus on creating, protecting, commercializing innovation, managing and monetizing IP. We are the association of experts who have some skill in doing this and want to help bring in a new professional group to be able to, again, effectively use IP to not only leverage, but invest in and stimulate development in new technologies. Our tagline is, we advance the business side of IP. So we have many, many partners working on acquisition of IP, creating IP. We're working on the business side, on the licensing side. This project is, you know, part of a number of activities we've been doing with the APO. We have an MOU that we updated in 2020. So again, proud to continue doing this. And we have a dedicated committee within LESI that also liaisons with the EPO to develop this curriculum. I'd be remiss if I didn't say we just restarted in-person meetings after 2 years of virtual meetings. We had a great event in Venice to kick off our 50th anniversary, and I was happily surprised. We had over 500 folks join us there in just a wonderful venue. The topics that we discussed were kind of the bread and butter of LES. And we really focused a lot on particularly four state of the industry briefings on automotive, telecom, life sciences, and energy and green tech. Sonia London, our expert panelist today, moderated one of those sessions, and we'll be continuing that discussion throughout the year. Because we were in Italy, of course, we had to talk about fashion and design. So we'll be making some of that content available. So keep pay attention for the release of all of that. So with that, I will introduce very briefly the expert panel. I will leave it to Sonia to introduce our case study, Francisco. But Sonia London is the general counsel for licensing at Tacotech. She's based in Finland. She's also a member of the LESI board of directors. And I'm happy to say this year she's managing our finances. She's our treasurer. So Sonia will be the expert panel chair and facilitate the discussion. We have three representatives, one from Europe, one from Asia, and one from North America. And Charlotte Lebien is joining us from our LES France Society. She's from Bird & Bird and a partner at that firm. And Charlotte is also a former LES France president. So thanks for joining us, and Charlotte. Hemeng Shah is with Qualcomm. He is the India engineering lead. Again, Hemeng has been very active in our society at LES. He's a co-chair of our high tech committee, among other things, among the other roles he's held at LES in the past. And finally, Matteo Sabatini is with Ericsson. He's the director of IP policy. Matteo is located here in Washington, D.C. with me, and is a member of LES USA and Canada. So with that, that's our expert panel that'll look at the case study from different geographic regions. And I will pass it over to Sonia to introduce our guest speaker. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dana. So the case study of today is super interesting. IonQ Inc., and we are talking about the licensing in the era of quantum. So IonQ has a deep roots in academia, and their mission is to build the world's best quantum computers to solve the world's most complex problems. The company has been established in 2015, and it is actually stock listed on the New York Stock Exchange last year. This way, IonQ is the first listed pure play quantum company in the world. And it's working hard to release the full potential of quantum technology. I'm sure we will learn more about that today. At our licensing forum, Mr. Dr. Francisco Castro, the chief IP counsel at IonQ, will explore the IP and licensing story of the company. So Francisco Castro is currently the chief IP counsel of IonQ. He has received his PhD from Drexel University in Philadelphia, where he studied applied and computational semiconductor physics. He had an early career in engineering as a principal research engineer at Lucent Technologies, which is now Nokia, and then later at Motorola. And he attended the Chicago Kent College of Law and transitioned to a career in intellectual property law at the Northern Virginia office of Silicon Valley-based law firm Cooley LLP. And most recently, just prior to joining IonQ, Dr. Castro was a counsel at Arent Fox LLP in Washington. Now, today, what we will discuss, soon we will hear, but we'll talk about the quantum industry and business models in there, building portfolio and university licensing, and importance of IP in managing company in that industry. So without any further ado, I would invite Dr. Castro to start his presentation. You will have a chance to send your questions through the Q&A function. So Francisco, please.
Thank you, Sonia, so much. Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here, and thank you for the opportunity to allow me to showcase IonQ and the exciting times we're having and just the environment, the technology and everything that's going on. Great. So a little bit of context. I wanted to tell you some background on the company history, and that will give you a little sense of the academic relationship between IonQ and its founders. The two founders from IonQ are professors. Christopher Monroe was a professor at the University of Maryland at the time of the founding of the company, and Jungsang Kim was a professor at Duke University at the time of the founding. They've known each other, they've worked together, they have been in this industry for about 25 years. In fact, Chris Monroe, one of our co-founders, was the first person to work on a quantum gate back in 1995. So that gives you a sense of how long these folks have been working on this area. Over time, they worked in very interesting developments in the area of quantum computing, all the way to more recently, in the last 5 or 6 years, that's when the company was founded. So one thing interesting also that the work for Chris Monroe that led to the first quantum gate was with Dr. Wineland, who received his Nobel Prize in physics in a related area of atomic physics. So what's the evolution of IonQ? Like I said, the co-founders, Drs. Monroe and Kim, had worked together, collaborating in certain projects. And here's a very interesting story of how things developed. They put together a paper where they sort of outlined what they thought a quantum computer would be, how it would be structured, what it would do, and how it should function. Somehow that paper made its way to a VC who saw it as a business plan. And contacted the professors and said, "What is this about?" He's like, "It's a paper we're going to present." And he said, "Well, no, this reads like a business plan to me." So that led to IonQ's founding in 2015 and an initial round of funding of $2 million to get the company going. Over time, IonQ was able to raise a Series A round of $20 million, then subsequently a Series B round of about $60 million. And build up some technology along the way. My relationship with the company actually started in 2017 when I was outside counsel for the company working on the initial IP developments that were being done by the company. And so I remained outside counsel until 2020 when I joined the company as chief IP counsel. Anyway, so a lot has gone on in very rapidly, which led to last year's, as Sonia pointed out, last year's event of IonQ becoming a public company. And here's a little bit of a picture of the excited group of folks from IonQ in front of the New York Stock Exchange the day that IonQ became a public company. You can't see me in the picture. I'm all the way in the back. So just to let you know, don't try to look for me. Anyway, so that's a little bit of background on the company to give you a sense of how quickly things are moving. But that also, it's based on 25 years of you know, a lot of work, a lot of research in this area. Now, the question that most of you may have is, what is quantum computing? And that would take hours to try to explain all the details. But I'm going to try to give you a very 5-minute, 10-minute presentation on what the basics are. And why is it that it's such an amazing area of technology and has such great potential? Very simply, a classical computer or a classical system, as we know them today, even you know, supercomputers, are based on a very simple concept. And that is that a bit of information can have one or two states, right? It could be a zero or one, on and off. And that can be perform in many different ways. You know, a simple switch would do it. Clearly, transistors is what we use as switches today to perform that simple computation. Well, those are the only two states it can be. It can be a zero or a one. For a quantum computer, what the basic unit is the basic unit of a quantum computer is a qubit or a quantum bit. Now, a quantum bit can also have a state of zero or off, or a state of one or on, but it can also have any states in between. It can have the ability to take a value that is anywhere between a zero and a one. And that flexibility, that ability to have an infinite number of values, is what gives a quantum computer, and particularly a quantum bit, the ability to perform computations that otherwise are difficult to do or take so much time on a classical computer. So rather than going into a lot of the details of how a quantum computer works, just logically or conceptually, think about the fact that with the same logical unit, a qubit, you can have an infinite number of possibilities. And that use of infinite number of possibilities is what makes a quantum computer so powerful, because you can make some computations using those infinite number of possibilities much more effectively than you would with a classical computer. There are a couple of quantum phenomena that also help quantum computers perform calculations that are uniquely powerful. And those two concepts are the concepts of quantum superposition and quantum entanglement. Now, these are not trivial concepts to grasp. I'll tell you right straight out. But in general, quantum superposition means that you can combine states, you can combine quantum states and generate another quantum state. If you go back to the earlier slide where I said, you know, a qubit can have an infinite number of possibilities. Well, you can combine an infinite number of possibilities with an infinite number of possibilities and come up with a new set of infinite number of possibilities, right? So it is extremely powerful and it's extremely flexible. So superposition gives you a great deal of flexibility. And the other phenomena is quantum entanglement. And this is really, really wacky. This is really crazy. And in fact, Einstein called it spooky action at a distance, because even Einstein couldn't figure it out, right? So this is the idea that two quantum states or two qubits, for example, can operate together. And that relationship remains even when you physically separate the qubits apart. So conceptually, this is one of the bases for the idea that quantum can allow teleportation, right? You have two things that are separated physically from each other, yet they're interacting with each other. So this is a crazy concept, but it's also a concept that is used in quantum computers to allow different qubits to interact with each other without them necessarily being physically touching each other. Again, the concept of quantum computing is a very complicated one, but the basis of the ideas that are, allow it to happen, the flexibility of the systems, the flexibility of qubits, the flexibility of combinations of qubits, and the infinite number of possibilities in the values of the qubits is really what makes a quantum computer so powerful. Everything else, obviously, is very complicated, and the math and the physics are. But just think about the basic concepts, right? The huge flexibility in the systems, the huge possibilities of values that can be calculated in many instances simultaneously. That gives quantum computers a great advantage. Now, the technology. Like I said, the qubit is the basis of a quantum computer. And logically, you saw that a qubit could have one value, another value, or a wide range of values. But how do you make a qubit? That's the question, right? There are a number of ways to make a qubit. There are numbers of ways to physically make a qubit. There's some natural qubits. Trapped ions is one technique. Neutral ions is another. Photonics is another. And I've listed here some of the companies that are using these various techniques. We use trapped ions at IonQ. There are other types of qubit technologies, and these are what are called synthetic or manufacturing qubits. These are qubits that are not naturally occurring. These are qubits that are made, man-made. For example, superconducting loops, silicon quantum dots, topological qubits, and diamond vacancies. Superconducting loops and trapped ions, on the other end, are the two most widely used types of qubit technologies. So you can see from superconducting qubits are used by Google, IBM, QCI, and Rigetti. So those are probably the most prominent names in terms of quantum computing that use superconducting loops. Again, all these technologies are very complex, but as you can see, there's so many different ways to implement a quantum computer because there's so many different ways where in which you can implement a qubit. How does IonQ use trapped ions? Well, I have two figures here. Hopefully they kind of give you a perspective of how complicated and how amazing the technology is, right? On the left is what is called an ion trap. An ion trap is able to hold ions in a line. You can see the light blue dots on top of the chip that is called the ion trap. And so it holds ions in that way. It's called a chain of ions. And then, as you can see from the right, the quantum module, the little white dots in that figure correspond to the blue dots on the left figure. And we essentially provide laser beams from one side and the other, control the states of the different ions, individually control the states of individual ions. Just think about how complicated that is. And then able to use a separate set of lasers to be able to read out what are the states of the different ions to be able to figure out what the results of the different calculations are. So by changing the states of the ions, by changing the natural state of the physical ion, we're able to make calculations, and then able to read out what the values of those calculations are. So this is how complicated a trapped ion architecture is. We have to control the lasers. We have to control all the characteristics of the lasers, the system, the environment. And just imagine how difficult it is to place ions a few nanometers apart from each other, as shown in this picture. And this is our individual systems at IonQ's facilities, and shows you the size of a quantum computer. While the figure before seemed pretty trivial, these are very, very large systems that require a lot of components, a lot of electronics, a lot of control systems, a lot of environmental controls in order to be able to have just a handful of ions floating in air so that you can hit them with laser beams. That's fun. All right, the licensing and IP aspect of IonQ. As I told you before, IonQ was founded by two professors who, by the way, are still professors at those universities. In fact, Chris Monroe actually has recently moved from the University of Maryland to Duke. So both him and Jungsang Kim are at Duke. So how did we get started? IonQ got started by getting an initial IP license from both Duke and the University of Maryland that allowed IonQ to have some initial technology to get itself started and be able to develop new systems and new technology. The terms of the license were really favorable, in part because it was not an unknown party. There were professors from the universities that were coming along, and there was an interest in the universities to actually promote the technology and make sure that it succeeded. Part of the agreement also, in addition to the initial license, we also got some option agreements, and that allowed us to add to the assets in the initial license over time, and use the universities, in a sense, use the universities as our original R&D effort and get IP license from the universities, not only from the initial license, but over time, we were able to add to that initial license. Our current efforts in terms of our IP portfolio, I just wanna say that we currently have over 200. I expect that sometime next year we'll probably be in the closer to 300 patent applications and patents that include both IonQ zone or licensed through the universities, and that is a significant growth in our IP portfolio over the 5 years that the company has 6 years now that the company has been going on. So a significant amount of it is through the license agreement and the option agreements. But as it stands right now, the bigger portion of our IP development is now all organic work. The business of quantum computing. So how do we use a quantum computer, right? Like I said, quantum computing itself is very difficult, but it has a significant amount of potential because of its ability to do incredible calculations that are very difficult to do, even with classical computers, including classical but supercomputers. So one of the ways in which we can actually monetize or provide services is using quantum as a service. So you saw some of our systems, in-house systems that we have, we control, we have the ability to calibrate, to monitor, to control its operations. And so we provide access to those systems through the cloud, and it could be through third-party clouds. For example, we currently go through Microsoft Azure, Google, and AWS, or it could go through our own private cloud. So there's a way for people and companies and individuals to actually access quantum computers through the cloud, and they would be accessing our computers in our facilities. Another way to generate revenue, which is not necessarily the focus of IonQ, but a lot of our partners are doing it, is consulting services and software development. They're developing algorithms and software solutions for particular industries and particular applications that run in our systems. And we help facilitate the development of those solutions. In a potential area of growth, which is not currently the focus, but is likely to be the case when the systems become more stable and more manageable, is the dedicated systems, so that clients or customers can buy their own computers. They can stay in premise, in our premises, or they can be or in the premises of the client or the customer. In that way, they have full control, full access to the systems, and perhaps are able to customize them to do certain functionality that you know, more generic systems do not. And I just wanted to show this as a general kind of idea of where things go, or where things are, and where things are going. We don't have specific numbers, but on the left side, you get a sense that the market is really dominated by either superconducting qubit companies or trapped ion qubit companies. The third option, which is called quantum annealing, is a different type of approach to quantum computer, which is more in line with like an analog type computer. They're very powerful, but also limited in some of the applications they can do. But that's a significant part of the industry as well. So most of what I talked about today was really related to gate-based quantum computers, which is what superconducting companies and trapped ion companies are sort of basing their technologies about. On the right-hand side, you can see a slide where, you know, I don't have the specific numbers, but it gives you a sense that while, you know, hardware and software are a big important part of what we're trying to build, kind of like in any computer development in the past, you need the hardware and then you need the software on top. But over time, you can see that the real value in the business and the market and the industry is going to be on the services side. So companies are able to develop solutions for particular industries, for particular applications, and able to work with customers to make sure that those solutions are effectively implemented and deployed, are going to be the drivers of the industry. And the hardware and software solutions will be, you know, the underlying ability to do so. IonQ sees itself as a hardware company for now, but our view is that eventually IonQ will transition to a services company once, you know, computers are more mature and hardware is able to sort of be self-sustained. So that is what I have for today. And I wanted to thank everyone for giving me the opportunity to showcase IonQ's exciting technology.